today we are going to be having a talk about the World War II and Greece, about a book that Jesse Hines, who is Professor Emeritus in the Computer Science Department, that he collaborated on with the gentleman that can explain to you how we met him, but he was in the Greek resistance in World War II. And I will share with you, which I did with some of the others, that it led to a wonderful experience, certainly for me, meaning having several, at least six trips to Athens, and becoming part of the Rigopoulos family. They've just been wonderful to us. But Rigas was a brilliant man and very brave, and that is what this book is about. And so I will let Jesse take it away and enjoy his talk.
Thank you. Richard, can we get the lights down?
Sure.
Okay. I got both switches up here, so that. Is that in the back?
That's
one. Oh, it's over here. I got
yeah.
Richard.
No, I got Jesse, I just want to say one other thing. I did get the food. I did not spend all night long. There's a new restaurant in Chelmsford Center, PETA. And it's a young, I put out some of the brochures. It's a young family that owns it. They were very nice to me. And I hope that if you decide to patronize the restaurant, that you'll tell them that you heard about it from the tourists at home. No, I gave a copy of the book to you, but that's
good.
Okay. Thanks.
Yeah, that's good.
Yeah.
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 Okay. So let me start off first by saying thank you. This is my third presentation to Lyra. And I'd like to thank you for inviting me back again. This subject is one as Bonnie said, it's very personal to us. We know the people involved. And we spent a lot of time on this story. But it's also a story that has a lot of controversy to it. And the reason it has controversy to it is that the situation that I'm going to talk about is phenomenally complex. As are most things today, which we all know. You know, whether you're a supporter of the current administration or not, you certainly will admit that the issues are complex. They're not as simple as people say they are. And when one talks about what happened in Greece during World War II, first of all, there may be people in this room who know more than I. And if you do, I invite you to comment on the things that I have to say. To just illustrate very briefly how complex things are. And I'm going to get into the history of this, but I just want to put this slide up. This is from Wikipedia. I found it this morning, ladies and gentlemen. This morning, as I was brushing up and reading, there's a wonderful Wikipedia article. If you just go to Wikipedia and type in Greek resistance, and then you click on the one that says World War II, you get to this. But I mean, the point is that the National Liberation Front was one Greek organization, the National Republican Greek League another, the National and Social Liberation, all these things, and they have, everything is referred to by acronyms. There's ELAS, ELAN, EKKE, I mean, on and on and on. It's very complex. So I'm trying to preface what I'm going to tell you as a story of, and here's the main issue. And I'm going to throw it right out at you, because anybody who knows anything, as I said, there may be people in this room who know far more than I about World War II. Certainly, I was born in 1948. The world was over, right? Okay? And I know some of you are older than I am. Some of you may have actually served in the war, etc. But here's the thing, and it's like the elephant in the room. To anybody who knows about this, I'm going to throw it right out now. The person I'm going to talk about, Rigas Rigopoulos, was not a communist, and he was not a royalist. And I have had Greek people come up to me after I've given this talk and said, that's impossible. That everybody at that time was either a royalist or a communist. Okay? The communists obviously were supported by the Soviet Union at the time. The royalists were supported by Britain and Churchill. Okay? And so this is the story I'm going to tell you about resistance that happened. And I want to read to you from the same Wikipedia article to give you a perspective. These organizations here were huge. There are 1.8 million people fighting for the communist side. This is in a population, ladies and gentlemen, of 7.5 million in Greece at the time. All right? So the resistance was huge, absolutely huge. But in the article from Wikipedia is this paragraph. Resistance in the cities was organized quickly, but of necessity, groups were small and fragmented. So what I'm going to be talking about is one of the small, very, very small groups, okay? I'm trying to give you this perspective, because without the perspective, it all kind of falls apart, right? Okay? The cities and the working class suburbs of Athens in particular witnessed appalling suffering in the winter of 1941 to 42, when food confiscations and disruptive communications caused widespread famine and perhaps hundreds of thousands of deaths. This caused fertile ground for recruitment. The lack of equipment, funds, and organization limited the spread of the resistance. The main roles of resistance operatives were intelligence and sabotage, mostly in cooperation with British intelligence. That's where Rigas was working. Okay? Got it? So I'm going to paint this whole picture for you, which is in the book, but I just want to read this to you because, I just found this. It's like perfect. It's just perfect to give you perspective. One of the earliest jobs of the urban resistance was helping stranded Commonwealth soldiers escape. Keep that in mind about something I'm going to show you. The resistance group stayed in touch with British handlers through wireless sets, met and helped British spies and saboteurs that parachuted in, provided intelligence, conducted propaganda efforts, and ran escape networks for Allied operatives and Greek young men wishing to join the Hellenic forces in exile. Wireless equipment, money, weapons, and other support were mainly supplied by British intelligence, but it was never enough. Fragmentation of the groups and the need for secrecy, the emerging conflicts between right and left, of course, being the British and the communists, okay? Monarchists and Republicans, again, the monarchists were the British and supported by the British, the Republicans by the Soviet Union did not help. Urban resistance work was very dangerous, you'll see that. Operatives were always in danger of arrest and summary execution and suffered heavy casualties. Captured fighters were routinely tortured by the Abwehr and the Gestapo and confessions used to roll up networks. The job of wireless operators was perhaps the most dangerous since the Germans used direction-finding equipment to pinpoint the location of transmitters. Operators were often shot on the spot, and those were the lucky ones since immediate execution prevented torture. Okay? That's where we go. You ready? Okay?
One question, Ben.
Yes, sir.
It would seem to me that the Germans would be very actively involved in trying to maintain this fragmentation.
Germans involved in?
The German occupiers would be very interested in maintaining the fragmentation. I wonder if you had anything on their involvement in trying to keep the groups in conflict with each other.
I'm not in a position to answer that question, okay? I'm not an expert on this stuff. What I'm telling is one man's story. It's a very good question. It's a good question, but I'm afraid I can't give you an answer on it. And I'd rather defer on questions that I can't answer than try to give you certainly my opinion. I really don't have an opinion, okay? Because all I know is through the eyes of Rigas Rigopoulos. Okay, so what we have is a personal story. And in this presentation, and you're welcome to interrupt me at any time with questions such as this, okay? What we have in this presentation is I'm going to talk about the story, but then there's a story to the story. Bonnie hinted at that story. How did this all come about? How did a professor of computer science end up working on the translation of a book about Greeks, which was written in Greek? World War II. It's another interesting story. And I get to that as well. And then talk a little bit, well, that's the third part. The other part is the people that we'll get into. So, this is a famous quote, I'm sure many of you know, especially the part in green, those who cannot remember the past are condemned to repeat it. And that's kind of how I first of all got interested in this stuff, is, you know, again, one of the things, again, that's thrown about in the discussions of our current administration is well, wait a minute, wait a minute, didn't we go through this time and that time, et cetera, et cetera. So this is one of my particular interests in history, but I'm not a history expert, ladies and gentlemen. Please, I'm not a history expert. But let's get started here. Now, what I am is Jewish. When I grew up, I was born in 1948, as I said. And I grew up hearing, of course, about the 6 million, the Holocaust. It was a big part of what my parents talked about. When we did talk about World War II, when I became old enough to begin to talk about things, understand things that happened, and as I grew and learned, and again, I'm not an expert on that either. But in perspective, when we talk about the 6 million, and we look at the deaths that occurred in World War II, we give it perspective that the USSR alone lost 29 million people. 29 million people. And Greece, with a population somewhere at that time around 9.5-10 million, lost 620,000 people. And what's not on this is this is the European dead. One place I read that we're here, we have a total of 47 million people. One place I read, and again, you have, these numbers, of course, are all approximations, obviously, okay? Some of them vary. If you look online, you look at various places, they'll vary by certainly as much as 10%, if not 20 or 30%. But some would say that China lost that many alone. Now, I don't personally know, okay? But I find the numbers staggering. Staggering. And now anybody can talk about wanting to repeat a war, et cetera, is an unbelievable thing. One thing I like to ask people, and I just throw it out there, is think to yourself whether man's constant, whether man's normal state is peace or war. Think about this. Think about our own country. When have we not been at war since the country was founded? Think about it, okay? I mean, it's an interesting proposition. So, this is the depressing part. There is, believe it or not, an uplifting part. So, let's take a look and see a little bit what happened. What happened? So, what happened is that in 1939, the Italians, the Axis forces, occupied Albania, and through Albania, the Italians attacked Greece, okay? So that much is a simple fact, right? That's a simple fact. Now, what then happened is that here you can see that 3 a.m. On October 28, 1940, representative of the Axis forces arrived in Greek Prime Minister's residence and demanded Greece's surrender. And the Prime Minister replied with one single word. And the word is no. Okay? The funny thing, my Greek friends always tease us that
no, yes.
That OE, which sounds like yes, sounds like we, that's no. And yes is Greek, I forget now, but it sounds like it's the other way around. So there's a video I'd like to show you. There's a video here. I have it cranked up a little bit ago, I hope. Nope, it's not there. Let's see, not there either. It's there. There's this, there's this. Here. Thank you.
The purpose of all of these Oki Day activities is to keep America and the world from forgetting and to help put into perspective the virtual evil incarnate in World War II that these people here helped defeat. And we all can imagine what our worlds in post-World War II would have been like had this greatest generation not defeated the Axis forces.
At 3 a.m., the Greek Prime Minister receives a call from the guards outside his residence, informing him that the Italian ambassador wished to urgently see him. The Prime Minister got dressed very quickly. He received the ambassador in his living room. The ambassador read what was basically an ultimatum, requesting that the Italian forces in Albania be given free passage into Greek territory. That was essentially a request that Greece surrenders and accepts Italian control. The Greek Prime Minister considered this message and he said, "Ohi, no, this is going to be war."
Greece today is a very, very tiny country. Think about the Greece of 1940, a very small country.
World War II was raging, and all the news on the Allied front was bad.
The Greek people had this kind of collective, spontaneous response.
They were chanting in the streets, they were singing patriotic songs, they were chanting anti-Italian slogans, and chanting no, ohi, to the Italians. Within a few hours, they were crossing the Greek border. The fighting was fierce. The Greek troops were much more poorly equipped than the Italian troops. And the terrain was so treacherous, it was very difficult to get supplies to the Greek troops on the frontier.
The Greeks were outmanned significantly, at least 10 to 1.
The Greek troops not only held their ground,
but they pushed the Axis powers back into Albania, which was really incredible.
The whole of Europe was astounded by the heroism of the Greeks. It was so unexpected that Hitler was very upset with Mussolini.
You can imagine him being confounded that such a spirited resistance was undertaken by the Greek people.
This was the first time that the Axis attack in Europe faced this reaction. People were determined not to let the Axis forces take over Europe because they believed in freedom and democracy.
That was really the first good news that happened in the early days of World War II. And psychologically, it was extremely important.
The narrative became one of the quintessential David and Goliath story. It shattered the myth of the invincibility of the Axis. It was picked up by news outlets throughout the world. The New York Times, Life magazine, Time magazine, everyone had the Greek story.
They inflicted a wound on the Axis forces that moved President Roosevelt to say, when the entire world had lost hope, the Greek people dared to question the invincibility of the Nazi monster rising against the proud spirit of freedom.
Winston Churchill said that Greeks are not known as fighting like heroes. Heroes fight like Greeks.
Greece's victory over the Italian attack had significant consequences for the rest of World War II. The Germans had to redirect their forces and bring in their own troops.
It certainly threw a monkey wrench into their well-laid plans, and as we know, may have affected the outcome of things.
If there had not been the virtue and courage of the Greeks, we do not know which outcome of World War II would have been.
Well, Hitler thought he could just subdue Greece in a weekend. It didn't turn out to be that way.
Russian statesmen, such as Joseph Stalin, Russian military leaders are on record saying that the delay in the Axis attack gave the Russians valuable months in which they could prepare themselves.
Or not for the Greeks, who knows what had happened? Who knows what the outcome would have been?
What made them do it? Why did they do it? What was it in the Greek character?
The Greek people instantly came together. They united as one in one voice. The reason for that was that they were fighting for their homeland, their freedom, and for democracy.
I think that the example of the Greeks standing up to Hitler, to Mussolini, the Axis power, is really inspiration, not just to modern day Greeks, but to people of all nations who cherish freedom and liberty and democratic principles can look to be inspired.
Okay, so I think at this point you got a pretty good idea of what was happening, right? Okay, of history. So now we're ready to turn to the story of secret war. So this is a picture of Rigas Rigopoulos. Rigas was born in 1914, and this is a picture of him with saying goodbye to his mother, as you can clearly see, on October 28, 1940. And went off to fight with his forces. Okay, he was a second lieutenant in the Greek army at that time. So, on March 7th, the British forces in 1941, the British forces arrived in Greece. But on April 6th, Germany invades Greece. What happens there is that, after, as you saw in the video, the Italians got pushed back, and so the Germans came in, and they were just overwhelming. They were just overwhelming, as they were in many places. So they invade Greece and Yugoslavia. Yugoslavia surrenders within, as you can see, 11 days. And then the British forces start to withdraw from Greece. And it's at this point that Rigas is working, and pardon me, Rigas was working down in Napoleon, which is here. I'm sure I'm pronouncing these names wrong. It's here. This is Athens. Athens is right here, and here's Napoleon. He was working there, and this is where the British retreated. Okay, as you can see, here's the German forces coming down these red lines, and that's what he was doing. And so after that, he returns to Athens. Okay, so at this point, Greece is defeated. All right, so Greece defeated now. So April 27th, Greece finally surrenders to the Nazis. And here, this picture here, I'm sure you recognize, is the Parthenon. Okay, and so this is the Greek flag, the Nazi flag, German flag being raised on the Parthenon. So the first act of resistance was on May 30th. So I go back here a second. So April 27th, a month later, these two students, they climb up on the Acropolis, and they tear down the flag, the Nazi flag. That's the first act of resistance. Again, what does it mean? They took down a flag, okay? But again, it was the beginning of the symbolization of the resistance in Greece. Okay, so the prime minister at that time, they form a whole Greek government in exile in London. And EAM is established. EAM, now again, the E stands for, I know, which is Greece. I'm not even going to try to pronounce the others, okay? And I'm not going to throw all these at you. There's not going to be any quiz again, all right? Okay? But this is 1941, as you can see. This is like, 6 months or so after Greece surrenders that the resistance starts. And so, and then of course the Avenger, this is 41, and just again putting things, the gray ones, just putting things in perspective. Everybody knows about December 7th, 1941, the attack on Pearl Harbor, etc. And according to my father says to me, I'll never forget this. He said, and again, people in the room are certainly, who are older than I, welcome to correct me on this. But my father said, you know, when they attack Pearl Harbor, everyone just get Japan, get Japan, get Japan. And they declared war on Germany kind of underneath while they were at it. This is what my father told me, okay? So I don't know if anybody feels differently about this. But he says it wasn't like over, because of course Americans were trying to stay out of the war at that time, as I understand it. Okay, so the winter of 1941 is when things really get bad. Where there's severe famine, and you know, I'm pausing because I'm hesitating because I'm not sure if that's when Rigas' mother died. Okay, but it may be. We're videotaping it for his son Dionysus, who I'll talk about, but Dionysus may correct me on that. But I know that there was a famine there, and it was severe famine. Many people starved, as they did in at the time Stalingrad, which is now, of course, St. Petersburg. So let's continue. So now things start to happen. April 42. So here's Rigas Rigopoulos. So who is this man? He's just a man. But he's a man of character, who people look up to. And they all think, well, Rigas is going to figure something out. He didn't have any plans. But so he said, okay, we're going to form this organization called Service 5165, which simply stands, as you can see here, this is the Greek, and it stands for the Hellenic Patriotic Society. So he used 5165 as the 5th, 15th, and 5th, 16th, and 5th letters of the Greek alphabet. So what happens is, now remember what I mentioned about the wireless operators, remember earlier? Okay, so he finds, now I'm not sure who Limberopoulos is, but he finds his radio operator, Palliatzaeus. And Palliatzaeus is a young man, and he's a radio operator, but he doesn't have a radio. And he finds Menegatos, who is connected to the British, and it's from the British that they're able to confirm radio transmission. So Palliatzaeus did have a radio, but they couldn't confirm that they were broadcasting, that the British were picking it up. So through this Menegatos guy, who had connections to the British Secret Service, they somehow confirmed that they're actually getting their transmissions. Now, what did they transmit? That's what we're getting into. Have I lost anybody yet? Any questions at this time? Seriously. Okay? I mean, it's the web of intrigue that's so fascinating, at least to me. Okay? That's the fascinating part of this. I keep an eye on my watch, too, so that we break, okay, at reasonable time, if you jump on me. Okay, if I go over. Okay. So May 22nd, that's when this ELOS was formed. Now, ELOS and is the, if I get this right, ELOS is the armed faction of EAM, which is again a communist organization. Okay? Communist organization supported by the Soviets. Okay? So that's formed. And then another act of resistance, a PAN or PEAN organization, blows up the pro-German headquarters of the ESPO, which is another organization. The number of organizations is absolutely phenomenal. As a matter of fact, let me go back here, press this, go back here, and if we scroll down more, here they are here. Okay? I mean, for me to even begin to comprehend, you know, or explain it, I can't do it. But I'm trying to impress upon you, again, what is the story that we're talking about? It's a story of an extremely small pocket of resistance, okay? Which is one of these many, many, many. As you can see, this one's here, the EAN, ELAS, this one here, these are the communist associated ones. These are the ones that are royalists, okay? And of course, as you know, and I'm not going to get into it, after World War II, then Greek had civil war, right? Then Greek had civil war between these factions, not knowing that Churchill and Stalin had already divvied it up, okay? Amazing, absolutely amazing. And so and then there's other, you know, all kinds of others, etc. So this is off that same Wikipedia page that I was talking about. And I mean, it just goes on and on. It's just incredibly complex what was going on. Okay, okay. One second. I did it right. What do you know about that? See, EAN, ELAS up here? So I said that ELAS, when I said here, is the orange faction of EAN. I did it right. Okay? Yes?
You commented Churchill and Stalin had already given it up. Did they agree?
Yeah, there's a secret.
The Soviets we were meant for, or have they disagreed? They would love to point it out.
No. Greece remained in the British sphere of influence.
Oh, in British.
Yeah.
That's why the communists.
Yeah. And that's why, that's one of the reasons. See, I have to be very careful because I'm not an expert on this, okay? But my understanding is that the Soviets didn't really support them in the Civil War, because the Soviets were doing other things, and they said, we've already given that to Churchill, so on we go, okay? But again, don't quote me on any of this. Okay? We're recording it for my Greek friends, so that they can see the presentation. But I hope I don't get ruined up on the news. Okay, so here's Rigopoulos. Here's this first in command, Mitsotakis. Again, these are normal people. Just normal people who are looking for a way. What can we do? Okay? Some of us, you know, you look around at what's happening here in this country and we're saying, what can we do? You know? All right? And this is exactly the situation they were in. So they're just simply looking for something to do so it turns out that, well, getting a little ahead of myself, so let me stop there. I don't get too far ahead of myself. So they find this Nikos Palaiotsakis, and he's a wireless setup operator. Okay, he was eventually executed by the Germans. I'll talk more about that. Okay, so he's a young man, and they find him, and he's got this wireless set. Doesn't know what to do with it. So they then get some others, and I'm trying to show you, and there's going to be some diagrams here to show how these people connect. But there are some other people. There's George Santillis, as you see here. He's an administrative liaison. See, one of the things Rigas was very worried about was, as he put the organization together, he was extremely worried about too many people knowing two other people, because people got captured, they got tortured, okay? And, you know, it wasn't so much things falling apart, it was just people get killed, right? So then here is where the wireless set was. Now this is an interesting picture. This is a picture taken when the book was first published. This picture was taken about 1971 when Rigas wrote his book. And you'll notice the high kind of block here at the top, and there's like a gutter that goes around the whole building. That's where the antenna was. The antenna was lying in the gutter. Okay? The antenna was lying in the gutter. This is the exact same building that I took a picture of in 2001. It's still there. So 2001, on one of our, we only didn't mention how many trips we made to Greece, but we made about 6 or 7 trips to Greece. I spent some time in Greece. I'll talk more about that. There's some pictures, etc., later on in the presentation. But I spent time, you know, working with Rigas one-on-one and with others too. But it's just fascinating. The same building. One day, Rigas said, "Enough working on the book. I'm tired." I said, "Okay, what am I going to say, right?" And he said, "Let's go for a ride." And we got in the car, and he took me to all the places. that we're talking about in the book. What fun that was.
Just tell them that what they do on a one-way street.
Oh, yeah. The one-way street is defined in Greece as a street you drive down backwards. This is that. But in the suburbs, I have maps. In a second, I'll show you a map. You'll see. Okay. It's just outside Central Athens. Yeah. Okay. All right. So here's the map.
Did it have any impact on it?
I don't know the answer to that.
It might have been under something. You might have had it in the gutter and then some covering over it so that the rainwater was not.
So here's Central Athens that we all know. And here's the Acropolis right there. Acropolis. And these are the places where various and sundry things happened in the book. The interesting thing here is that their connections to Pyrrhea, the main thing that Service 5165 did, the main thing that they did was they broadcast the arrivals and departures of Greek ships out of the port of Piraeus that were then torpedoed and destroyed by Allied forces. That's the main thing that they did, okay? There's a little bit more information about that for later. But these other places, the Academy, Platonus is some of there's one of the people in the book worked there, and Kessariani is where people are executed, and Kipseli is the place, if I have it correctly or remember correctly, this is where the wireless set actually was. That picture that you saw, I believe it's north of Athens up there. And but frankly, I can't remember the connection to Nazi-occupied, but this connection as well. Okay. So here's how intimate. Yes.
What were the German soldiers doing with this?
Ah. Okay. Well, and this is not from the book, so this is just other stuff I've read, Harry. Okay. So the thing is that the Germans were, first of all, they were involved in the countryside, which is where most of the real resistance was, okay? And second of all, it was very disorganized, and everything was secret. And so they were trying to find people. That's what they were trying to do, find them. But it wasn't as organized as you see in movies and things like that, you know? Okay, that's the best I understand. Yes?
Well, for fans of World War II movies, you would see these German trucks going around with radio direction boxes.
Yes.
Trying to locate.
That's for sure. Yeah, that's for sure. And so they only broadcast at certain times, and they randomized it, things like that. And there's some things there too, what times they broadcast. Okay, so here's the central administration of Rigas and a couple of other people. That's the wireless operator, that's Palaiotsaios. Okay? So Palaiotsaios was connected to Menegatos, and Menegatos was connected to the kite captain. Now what's a kite? Well, there's a picture of a kite a little later, but it's simply, in simple terms, a boat that has both a motor and sails. Okay? It has motor and sails. There's a picture of it later of a kite. Okay? So they're out there in the Aegean Sea, and they're monitoring these boats coming and going and connecting back. Okay. So this is a little reenactment that Rigas and I did. This is right out of the book, and we did this. So this is where he first met Menegatos, and somehow through connections, etc., Rigas said that the question was, do you have a lighter? Yeah, there it is. Do you have a lighter? And Rigas's answer was, no, but I have matches. That's how they knew each other. Okay? That's how they knew each other. And then when they sat and talked, of course, this is me and this is Rigas, of course, they offered Menegatos, who was connected to the British, had money. He offered gold sovereigns, which would support you know, his activities. And Rigas turned it down. Okay? Now, this is another one of these things that people say to me, when I made this presentation in other places, people would say, not possible. Okay? Not possible. Well, I can tell you this is what Rigas told me. Okay?
Why
turn it down? Because in his words, what he told me was that they didn't really need money, okay? They needed the connections, but not really money, he said they wanted to do what they did for the love of Greece. Again, you can take this with a grain of salt, This is what I was told. Okay, so here are independent people. So we have Menegatos as a liaison to the Allied Intelligence Service. He would travel to and from Turkey with written information and drawings. He was executed when we found him. And there's other ones here, and again, you can read these. You can read these.
You don't want to say the names.
No, I can't really pronounce them all. Although there's a wonderful picture you'll see later where I shocked Rigas with by the time I finished the book, I was able to at least sound out words with Greek letters. Okay? There's a wonderful picture a little bit later that I'll get to. Okay, how are we doing on time? Okay, got about 10-15 minutes here. So okay. So through the wireless, they're connected to the Balkans Information Center. This is not the SOE. The SOE, again, I'm sorry, I can't remember off the top of my head what all these things stand for, but the SOE was the British Secret Service. That I absolutely know, okay? But it's not the British Secret Service that they're directly connected to. They're connected to this Balkans Information Center, which then is transmitting information. And the big connection that they had, as I said earlier, was to people in Piraeus Harbor, which was the main harbor there, okay? And they had this fellow, Manolis here, and they reported on the movement of ships and convoys, warlord material, mines, minefields laden with the sea, etc. So they were able to say where the mines were laid. You know, this is, of course, very helpful information. This is the kind of information. And according to Rigas, the information provided by this division resulted in the sinking of 55 ships. Okay, this is what Rigas claims, and it is recognized by the Greek government, which we'll get to later. Rigas received the Distinguished Cross from this government for his work. So you'll see that later. Okay. So here they had the harbor master second in command. So all these people who, because you know, if you know anything about these harbors, there's always a pilot that goes out to guide the ships in, you know, who knows the harbor, knows everything underwater and all that stuff. Okay. But they're all involved in resistance. They're all involved in resistance. Okay, so that's what we have here. And these wonderful pictures, by the way, you know, it was a whole epic struggle to find all these pictures and get them. And you know, I scanned, you can tell some that many of them are scanned, like this one here, you can see them, et cetera. I scan them, size them, they're all in the book, which I'll talk about more later. So again, there's more here. And Jarkopoulos, there's a whole story about him and what he did, which we'll get to. But these are all people at the harbor. So that's from Piraeus Harbor. They got general information as well. And the general information, they had this guy Stavros, he was a chemical engineer and lecturer. There's the National Technical University of Athens, which was that one up in the corner on the left corner there, okay? And as you can see, he drew diagrams of enemy installations. He just drew stuff. And they were able to transmit information about, they couldn't transmit the drawings, so they drew stuff about the drawings. Although Menegatos was taking them back and forth, which is how he got caution. Okay, he was taking these drawings back and forth to Turkey. Very, very complex. Okay, so here's additional people again, through people, etc. And these are people that were also involved.
I know, yeah.
And more and more people who are, and you can see, you know, Atlas Cement Factory. I mean, you know, they were building fortifications. So, okay, here's what's going on. So that they had the information. And then on the railway division, there was
Poppy
Sackett. We met Poppy. We met Poppy in Britain. She lived in Britain after this, soon before she passed away. And you'll see another, this Alex Kairis and Rigas were both in love with Poppy. And that's a whole other story. That's a whole other story. And she had letters, which I'll talk about. So again, more and more people just trying to the web of these people. And then they had the pièce de résistance, they had Alexander Kayuris. Alexander Kayuris was an employee of the German engineering community. And he penetrated the confidential archives and provided them the most valuable information. And he was a very close friend of Rigas. And we'll talk more about him.
So Jesse is going to continue on with his talk. He's going to say a little bit something about the books. And I enjoy this experience, but I know I find it difficult to not talk about my part of the experience as well, but it's my part of the experience, not the book, but other travels and things. And I'm glad to share that information when I'm not at the student with Jesse. So enjoy.
Okay, thank you. So the book that I'm talking about, Secret War, is here. This is the book. It was originally written in Greek. As we said, we brought it into English. I'll talk about how that happened. But people are asking, you see people taking it, etc. We are not charging for it. You can have it for free from us. What we're asking for, what the basket is for, are donations. Those donations will all be given to the Lira Scholarship Fund. Okay? It will be given to the Lira Scholarship Fund. So you can put in there whatever you like. And help yourself with the book. We run out of books. We have. Okay. I want to go back just a little bit, since Bonnie asked me to mention the book and others did too, and read you just a little bit from the book. Here's a passage about this Captain Petros Trakopoulos. I'll just try to read this for you. So Captain Petros Trakopoulos rounded out this team. He was fated to be our last of our organization executed by the Germans at the end of 1944. All of them were seasoned captains, hardened to the sea. They were ghosts of the harbor who knew everything and everybody in the sailing world, and they developed a further network of informants known to us. September came, this is September 1944. September came and the Germans were preparing to leave. They finally declared that they would free the prisoners. They no longer had any reason to execute patriots. On the contrary, they had every interest in soothing their retreat by not infuriating the Greeks and allies any longer. The day the prisoners would be released was announced. On the morning of September 8th, Petros Drakopoulos' wife cheerfully took her children and went to meet their father outside the prison. Many others were also waiting there to take their loved ones home. A notice listing the names of prisoners to be released was posted on the prison door. The crowd was in a festive mood. An alarming rumor was verified short time later. The prisoners were no longer there. The SS had picked them up in trucks at daybreak. What could they have wanted with them? Where had they moved? Out of breath, the prisoners' relatives reached the SS office on Merlin Street. There they found some baskets full of clothes. Everyone ran to examine the baskets, agonizing over what they would find. One of Trakopoulos' daughters found a little basket containing her father's clothes. These are the personal effects of the executed, the guards said. The day of joy turned into a day of tragic lamentation. The vengeful mania of the defeated oppressor had been revealed with incredible sadism. Which of the ghastly monsters had given the order to execute 72 people who were expecting to be freed that morning? This was the last mass execution, the symbolic apex of a four-year-long tragedy that the conqueror wanted to leave in the Greek memory. It was the final wrathful gesture of a bloodthirsty tyrant who was despised, undermined, and humiliated by indomitable slaves. The 72 prisoners had been led to the firing squad at dawn, believing that they were being led to freedom. Only when they reached the ravine in the Daphne area and found themselves surrounded by machine guns, only then did they realize the terrible truth. At that point, the tragic chorus of 72 condemned people began to sing our national anthem. Among them was our indomitable pilot, Petros Trakopoulos. Among them were other people. Leona Karagiannis, a heroic woman who led a clandestine struggle that became legend. was the final display of patriotic grandeur that had been established on a day of the unforgettable. Kostas Perikos had first set the example, faith in Greece and courageous confrontation of an honorable death. A young saboteur, Yanis Houpas, pounced on a machine gun and turned it on his executioners, but he didn't know how to operate it. The Germans fired their first shots into him. Then the ravine roared with the howling guns, drowning out the proud Greek soul. This is how Petros Dracopoulos fell, the final loss of Servius 565. He had not wanted to accept that we had been defeated after our persecution, and he continued to struggle until the last moment. His spirit remained youthful and indomitable, even in his 60th year. They had been arrested in 1943. No, I'm sorry for my, you know, it's like I spent years and I kind of like knew these people, you know. So I apologize. So let's continue, because this one is also, this is Rigas' friend, Alexander. So before I read that part, so here's what happened. So we had Alexander Kairis, the new important member of our service, who opened the doors for us to the German headquarters of southern Greece, to the top secrets of the Germans, to the heart of the enemy. This new acquisition, the acquisition being Alexander Kairis, to our service was a landmark development, playing on the trust he had built up with the Germans. Kairis was stealing their secrets right out of their hands and facing real danger head on. However, he developed for us a new, extensive, and irreplaceable source of information that was worth every danger and sacrifice. So, in 1943, the Allies sank 5 German ships based on information from Service 5165. Again, I can't verify this, ladies and gentlemen. I've had people call me to task on this, this wasn't possible, etc. I'd say these things, I mean, I believe what I was told, but I say them because I'm trying to paint the truth here, okay? I'm trying to paint the truth. And so, this is what we believe. Then the Germans, soon after that, they capture Menegatos as he delivers information to the Pipes. Remember the Pipes we talked about? Okay, so he's delivering this information, they capture him. And then they search for it and they find the wireless set. Now, hang on 1 second. Okay, so this is again on the trip that Rigas took me to see all these places. And so, this is the church where he went after learning of Palaiotsaeus' arrest. Palaiotsaeus was the only man operating a wireless set, remember? Okay? And Rigas also narrowly escaped arrest himself, which is another interesting story. He was hiding with a couple. He was in their apartment, and the Germans were knocking on all the doors. And Rigas had 2 guns, and he just went off the fire brigade to knock them, and they opened the door. They never knocked on the door. And he said to the others that he was going to leave, but they insisted he stay there to hide him. I mean, you know, the heroism of these people is just mind-boggling. It's mind-boggling. So, yeah, earlier in the day, he and second-in-command Mitsos Ridaitis had planned to go to a barbershop that Palaiotsaeus often frequented to inquire about his whereabouts. They armed themselves and headed out, but then postponed the action because of an opportunity arose to send messages abroad to a trusted friend who was escaping to the Middle East that day. They later found out that the Gestapo had the barbershop staked out and were lying in wait for them. Had they gone, they would have most certainly been killed. And this is what Rigas wrote at that time. Those are his words. I don't know if I can read these. There are moments in life when you definitely sense the presence of God at your side. You feel small and powerless before his greatness. You do not judge and you do not interpret his inscrutable will. All you ask for is a church where you can light a candle and humbly worship his grace. This is how I felt that night at St. George Square in Cape Sally. I saw a church in front of me. I went up the stairs, pushed through the half-open door, and stood in a corner. There I slowly regained my composure. I wanted to believe that everything would work out well in the end. And this is a picture I took of him. Quite see it. He's here. By the candlelight. See it? See it over, he's over on the side. So, this is all, I mean, you know, part of, I'll get into how I met him and how that all happened. Okay, so let's continue to try to get through the story. We're almost at the end. Okay, so, April 24th, 1943. Rigopoulos warns Kyrgyz that the Germans are on to him. He advises Kyrgyz not to return to work and to flee Greece. Kyrgyz says no. The information I bring directly from the German, this is Kyrgyz, he's quoting Kyrgyz, the information I bring directly from the German headquarters is invaluable and irreplaceable. If something happens to me, some way will be found for our organization to continue its work. If I abandon my position, a considerable void will be created in our overall mission. We dedicated our lives in the moment we started this struggle. Can any of us be certain that he will survive to the end? I, at least, believed from the beginning that it would be improbable to get through all the dangers we face alive. So the only issue that remains is how can we hurry to offer more? That is the heart of the matter. This is why I will definitely show up at my work on Tuesday. Whoops. So Tuesday after Kyrgyz, Kyrgyz returns to work and is immediately arrested. Okay. A month later, Palitzakis and Trotis, the kite captain, Menagatos and Salinas, they're all executed. And then in late May, Kyrgyz is tried for the first time. He's defended by the Jerusalem Archbishop. He's acquitted. But he gets tried again, and he's again acquitted. And finally, they bring in, well, that's on October 18th, so I'm a little ahead, we'll come back to that. But on October 18th, they bring in a special judge, and that judge convicts him. Okay? They were going to get him one way or the other. At the same time, Rigas escapes to Turkey. He gets to Turkey, but he's duped by the British services. There's a whole other thing going on here, okay? Because there's rivalry in the British services. And again, people have been asking me questions. I don't know, ladies and gentlemen, all the subtleties of all these things. I'm not an expert on this, okay? But he's interrogated. He thinks he's talking to the people that he's been communicating with, the Balkans Information Center, but he's not. He's talking to the British Secret Services, the SOE, which is the other branch of the service. And so he's interrogated by them, and requests a new wireless set to return to Greece, and they refuse him. And so he becomes a special consultant to the Prime Minister.
Which Prime Minister, the British or the British?
I think it's the Greek Prime Minister.
Oh,
okay. Greek. Yeah, I think. I don't think it was Churchill. So he's not working in church. Then it's a government in exile.
Oh, okay.
It's government in exile. Okay. So he leaves the service in September and he begins training with the Sacred Squadron. The Sacred Squadron, then there's stuff about that. That's another whole thing. Just amazing stuff. That he's commanding a kite in the Aegean Sea. You'll see that. Okay. So here he is. Here he is in 1944, and that's Rigas there, and Rigas is also right here in this picture, back here. Okay. So here's a kite I talked about, okay? So it has both a motor and a sail. Oh yeah, they're small. Okay. So we've already talked about that. We talked about Jacopoulos being executed. And finally, on October 12th, the British troops arrived and the Germans pulled out of Athens. Mm-hmm. And this is the liberation of Greece. So here's where they push them back. Mm-hmm. And by the way, also here, and I know it's small and you can't read it all, but you can certainly see that there are 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7 circles. Those 7 circles, they're all resistance groups. Okay? And some of them are cooperating. Others are fighting each other. Okay. You know, it's just amazingly complex. Amazingly complex. Okay. So October 1444, Rigopoulos returns to Athens, the Greek government exile returns, and December 4th, civil war breaks out. Okay. Civil war breaks out. And that's about where the book ends. Okay, this is a picture of Rigas' identification card. Let me just check in my notes here. 1 second. Yep. Okay. So these are the Greek names of the people of the service who were killed. And what happened in 1945, November 3rd, 1945, exactly 2 years after the execution of Alexander Kairos, Parnassus Hall in Athens was filled to capacity with a dense crowd. They had come to join us in showing gratitude to those who had given their lives for us all. Boy Scout honor guard manned the entrances and kept order. The podium was covered with a large Greek flag draped all the way to the floor. 6 small laurel wreaths were placed on top. The unfurled flag at the base of the podium. It's not easy to provide a complete picture of how we honor our dead that day or to relate the emotional response of our public in just a few lines. But I will sketch it as I deliver. Which began with a roll call of the dead. On the day of freedom, when the roll was called for all those who fought, who struggled, who gave their lives and bodies for the soul of Greece. Among many others, 6 men of ours have fallen. Our fallen friends, in that special roll call today, we'll hear your answers, sent from the strings of the secret bonds that join us. Let us know by your presence, good friends, as I call each of you by name. Alexander Kairos, Nikos Palaitseas, Petros Kirkopoulos, Nikos Mercados, Stramatos Tratis, and Socrates and Silenus. Okay. Now, so then what happened? Then what happened, in this emotion-charged atmosphere, in return for the laurel I offered for Alexander Kairos' family, I accepted the greatest gift of honor and love that I could ever have wished for. Alexander's brother handed me a sheet of paper on which my lost friend had written a poem for me. It had been found among his prison papers. It had been, through tear-filled eyes, I could only discern the title Rigas Farewell and the familiar signature. Alexander, Athens, Avros Prison, June 1943. I put the paper in my pocket and we silently gripped each other's hands. So this is a poem that he wrote, and it's an English translation,
Jesse, it's getting a little hard to
hear. Oh, okay. To Rigas, my brother, the selected one, a few words. The eternal separation was destined to come. Yet the path we walked together raised me from the trivial to heights. Around me is dazzling light. Oh, such a great road for a wayfarer. How joyful. Even the taste of death feels worthy. But think, deep within you, the journey is not yet completed. Ahead await a few, oh, what a thought, miles. Alone, from now on, get fast to the end. And now, brother, tears, kisses, and whines, far from you, a heartfelt handshake is only right. Farewell. The interesting thing about that was that this is an actual photograph. When we met Poppy Sakalaridis in London, she had love letters from him that were smuggled out of prison. And I held those in my hand, and I said to her, you know, and I looked at her and I said something about, can I copy them, can I this, can I that? And she said, no. She said, I'm going to be buried with these. That's what she said. She wouldn't let me do anything. So, the next thing we have, so that's the story. So, now, okay, good. So now, this is Rigas himself.
Hello, my friends. I wish to be there today to see you, to talk with you, and tell you some details about this horrible and at the same time great period of the enemy's occupation in Greece. Unfortunately, this was not possible. But Jesse Hans, my friend, who had the extreme courage to initiate and edit the book from a language that he didn't know. Jesse is there, and will tell you everything I will tell you because he knows the whole story as much as I do. Instead, I will just tell you a few words, especially about one of my friends among the six members of our organization who have been executed for being spies in Athens. This friend of mine, a childhood friend, was Alexander Kairis. In prison, condemned to death, he has written some poems. And I believe that if I tell you one of these poems in Greek and in English, you can withdraw some conclusions. Much more words of me wouldn't make you withdraw. So, allow me to read you, or better, to show you the well, this is the his own writing, and it's a poem he addressed to me, a farewell poem, knowing that in a few days he would be shot. I will read you this poem. First in Greek, and then in English. Ρίγα, γεια σου. Στο Ρίγα το μεταρχοποιητό, το διαλεχτό, δύο λόγια. Γραμμένο να φτάσε χωρισμός παντοτινός. Μα όμως, η στράτα η βαδισμένη κοινά, απ' τα χαμνά σαν όλια μα ψήλωσε. Γύρωθε θάμπος να είναι σάμπος, ο δρόμος σε στρατάρι τέτοιος χαρά του και θανάτου τη γεύση πλέρια αξίζει. Μα το χάσου η βαθά σου. Ακόμα δεν απόσυσε ο δρόμος, μπροστά πια λιγοστά ο σκέψη προς μέλλον μίλια, μονάχος πια φτάσε ταχιά στο τέρμα. Και τώρα αδέρφη, δάκρυα, φιλιά και κλαψιμιά μακριά σου, χεριού ένα σφίξιμο γκαριαστό, μόνο σωστό, γεια σου. Αλέξανδρος, Αθήνα, φυλακές Αβέροφ, Ιούνιος 1943. And now the same poem in English. Rigas, farewell. To Rigas, my brother, the selected one, a few words. The eternal separation was destined to come. Yet the path we walked together raised me from the trivial to the heights. Around me is a dazzling light. Oh, such a great road for a wayfarer, how joyful even the taste of death feels worthy. But think deep within you. The journey is not yet completed. Ahead await a few of what I thought miles. Alone from now on, yet fast to the end. And now, brother, tears, kisses, and wines far from you. A heartful handshake is on the right. Farewell. Alexander, Athens, aware of prisons, June 1943. Well, this was the poem given to me by the brother of Alexander after the liberation.
So let me start now to talk about the story, how this all came about. This is Dionysus Rigopoulos. He's Rigas's son. He's Rigas's son. And this is his wife, Terry, here. Okay. Now, so what happened was, way back in 1999, which is the date you see here, I applied for a Fulbright scholarship to do some studying in Greece, as many professors to get Fulbright scholarships to do things. And I got turned down. I got turned down for that particular application. But it was Dionysus who I was communicating with, because his doctorate is from Carnegie Mellon. And so he and I communicated. He said, well, come to Greece anyway. If you pay your airfare, I'll find a way to pay for the other stuff. And we went to this conference together in Sparta. Perfectly innocent. Two professors going to a conference together in Sparta, okay? And so we went to this conference together. And on the way home, we're sitting on the bus next to each other. We go past this monument, and he says to me, and the monument goes like that. This picture I got off the internet, not a picture I took. And so it goes like that, and he says, oh, you just passed the monument to my grandfather. I said, oh, yeah? He said, yeah. He said, my grandfather was killed in the war. I said, oh, sorry. He said, yeah. So turns out that it's an interesting story about Christos Karbounis. Now, let's see, I can tell you the story, and I might have it written here, yeah. Okay, so this is from an article by Mark Fritz from the Boston Globe in 2001. So few resistance groups killed more Germans or suffered heavier reprisals than the Greeks, who fought off Italy's invasion so effectively that a humiliated Mussolini had to be bailed out by the Germans. The Greeks lost a dozen towns full of people for a lone guerrilla attack on a Nazi regiment, and more than 500,000 lives total for being one of the fiercest occupied countries. So what the Germans did is they announced that if any German soldier was killed, they would kill 100 Greeks, okay? But the Greek resistance was also hopelessly split among various factions. We've talked about that. From the monarchists to communists to democrats to demagogues. Guerrillas operated out in the countryside, and the Nazis found it handier to carry out reprisals in the cities. Let me read that again. Guerrillas operated out in the countryside, but the Nazis found it handier to carry out reprisals in the cities. The cause and effect between an attack on a supply train and a city full of dead people wasn't always clear or cared about. Okay? Dr. Christos Karbounis was a physician held in prison, not as a criminal, but as collateral. A big German supply convoy was coming to town, and the Nazi invaders decided to lock up some locals. Word went out that the town doctor and 117 other detainees would be executed if the resistance dared launch an ambush. It did, and they were. Okay. So the story here is that, again, this word of mouth is that he was, what it says here is true, he was one of these people held in collateral, and they offered to let him go because he was a doctor, and this, and he had actually treated, according to what Rigas told me, he had actually treated German soldiers. Okay, and they said that they would let him go, and he said, no, you can't let me go and kill 116. So he was killed as well. So this is Rigas and Annie. This one I took when we visited one of our trips in 1999, when we first met. And so part of the story is of how I got into this is, and I'm sure you've all had this experience, that you meet someone for what any reason it is. You get introduced to a person, and all of a sudden, boom, there's just some simpatico you have. And I cannot explain why I got attached to Rigas, but I did. It was just almost instantaneous. And the interesting thing is that Rigas loves to tell that there were two other people before me who tried to translate his book, okay? And he didn't like the translations. And he always said, who would think that a computer science professor, okay, would take the time? And you're gonna see in a second the actual translator, how he did this. But it was just one of those things, you know, that we just hit it off. So here is Eleni Didoglu, I found as a student at UMass Amherst. She's a Greek, and so she, I found her, and I hired her, and I told her, just give me a rough translation of the book, and I'll smooth all the English, which is exactly what we did. And so she produced this very rough translation, and gave it to me in Word, you know, and then I worked on it. I made about 5 trips to Athens over the years to meet with Rigas and work on it. And there's some pictures here that I'll show you too. But this is Eleni. And her father owns a Greek
restaurant. It's in our house.
Yes, it is in our house. But her father owns a Greek restaurant.
I didn't mean that to Eleni comments.
Yeah, this is Dionysus. One of the times he was here, they were looking together at something. And they're actually reading the Greek version here. Because at that time we didn't have the English version. Her father owns a Greek restaurant. Where's it? Lentz?
He used to own in Lawrence.
Lawrence is a Greek restaurant. Okay. So here we are working. This is on one of my trips. You can see there's an English Greek dictionary right there. There's Dionysus and Rigas. And this is John Fortunus, who is Dionysus's father in law.
Okay?
Yes.
Did Rigas understand English?
Oh, yes.
Because I was wondering how he could not like the translations if he didn't.
We had a lot of arguments over words. And there were certain times I had to say to him, because of course, most people in Europe speak British English. And so I would say to him, Rigas, Americans aren't going to say it that way, you know? And so we got into things like that. It's just a whole other thing. Okay?
He was a brilliant man who spoke many languages.
Yeah. So now, a couple things about this picture I want you to notice. So what's happening here is he's actually reading the Greek version. He's reading the Greek version. I am reading aloud the English version. This is how we did it. So he would read the Greek and hear me reading the English version. Okay? So, and he'd say how it sounds. Okay? Does that capture what I'm trying to do? Okay? I mean, Dionysus himself speaks, as I said, he's a PhD from Carnegie Mellon. I mean, you know, he speaks, he's a little accent, but he speaks with perfect English. And so does John Fortunus. They all speak, I mean, Greece is a small country. They all speak English. Okay.
And most of them have relatives here.
So now here, though, the next picture is my favorite of all time. Okay, my favorite of all time. Okay. Do you notice anything interesting about this picture? Can you tell why this is my favorite of all time? I'm pointing to the Greek to show him where we are. I'm pointing to the Greek. Immediately after this picture was taken, both Dionysus and Rigas together said, wait a minute, how'd you do that? And I said, come on, I've been working on this. You know, at this point, we've been working on it for 2 years or so. And I said, so I could follow it all, okay? I could follow it all. So this is my favorite. Okay, so here we are. This is a picture with the finished product. And this is Rigas signing it for me. And so Dionysus loved to take pictures. We were fighting over differences in words. And this again happened, this is later, this is when in September 2004, Bonnie and I were not there. We weren't able to make this trip because September 23rd I was still teaching. It was impossible to get away during the semester. But here's where he went to the, whoops. This is the presidential mansion. This is Terry, this is Rigas. And here he is receiving the cross from the President of the Republic. He's 86. He passed away. According to Dionysus, Andy passed away first, which was amazing, because Andy was 15 years younger than he was, at least something like that. And he was amazed, you know, couldn't believe that Andy passed away. But he was rightfully and fully cognizant, everything, you know. Just according to Dionysus, he had brushed his teeth and gotten ready for bed, sat down on the bed. We should all go that way. You know? We should all go that way.
Getting ready, he's working on his
computer. Yeah. And this is where he's
yes. The Golden Cross in 2006 for his service in World War II.
That's correct.
60 years later.
Yeah, that's correct.
Was his book helpful in?
It was out in 1971.
Did it help him in receiving the award?
I don't really know. Again, you know, I'm sorry to have to say I don't know about certain things, but I don't know all those fine details. So that's my presentation, and to repeat, this is just from Amazon.com. The book is there, and you can see.
What's the significance
of the design?
Yes.
The design is just a design. It's just a drawing, and you can see, if you look at it very closely, people suffering. It's just suffering. And the Greek, this mystical polemos, that means secret war. So that's what is there. But as I said, the books are here. You're welcome to take one. If you feel so inclined, you can put something in the basket, and we will turn over all that and from there to there. And so now I'll try to take what questions you may have in the time that we have remaining. Yes?
What did he do after the war?
Well, he did a lot of different things. He was an artist, and he worked in a variety of different positions after the war. I don't
know for sure. What do you mean when you say
artist? He was actually even the governor of a city, or mayor of a city at one point. So, but he worked for government, he had various government positions.
So he was cooking with his son?
Oh yeah, that's what the video was for. His son, there's some family here. They have family in Boston, and someone was going to, somebody else was going to come, but was unable to come, so they asked him to try to set up the camera, so captured. Yes? Basically, I'm on really thin ice here, okay? I'm on really thin ice, but basically, it's the communist forces against the royalist forces, those who supported the king and the government that was in place before the war, okay? It was a dictatorship before the war. So that's not the most pleasant of things either. But that was the government before the war. Yes. Yes, he is. Yes. Dionysus is the man I met initially. And then he introduced me. When I said to him, wow, that's really interesting about his grandfather. Okay?
Who was the other side of the family?
The other side of the family.
Ani was Rigas' wife.
Yeah.
The man that just the doctor had told you that said, take me with the soldier, that was Ani's father. But Dionysus said to Jesse, if you think that's great, you should meet my father.
Oh,
And so he took Jesse, that was the first meeting.
Yeah.
And we had another commitment, actually in Poland, but I was to meet Jesse in Athens, and we met this family, and I told some of the others, I thought I would never get to Greece again. So we went to all the tourists on the Acropolis, and there was a museum at the time, which, by the way, if you get to go to Athens, there's a new Acropolis museum. Now, when they excavate to build these things, they see what they're finding, so they put glass. When you enter the new Acropolis museum, you walk over glass because they want you to be able to see. But anyway, that's when Jesse and Rigas, they just bonded, as you said, and Rigas told us this story, and he said, Americans, you know, we have to get it in English because Americans will be so interested. Some are, you know, but they were wonderful people. They were here, you were asking about, in 2016 they came because now Dionysus and his wife have a son who, in the tradition, the Greek tradition, the son is named Rigas, and he's 15 now, and they're looking for colleges and things like that. So we got a chance to spend time with them in the United States, which was very, very wonderful. We just part of the family. It just has been a wonderful relationship.
The other thing I wondered, is the greatest fight in the Civil War that
No, he did not. No, he did not. I asked him that question. I did ask him, and he said no. He said he couldn't. He said, "How could I kill another Greek?" Basically, what he said. Again, when I told these stories, you know, which are certainly secondhand, if not thirdhand, right? And people have challenged me. You know, what you're saying can't be true. I can only repeat what I was told.
So, why would he say that?
Well, because they said everybody was either a communist or a royalist. You know, couple of people that I presented to, I presented to Hellenic societies and things like that, where people, I can't say they're wrong. I can't say they're wrong, but this is what I was taught. And by the way, I just thought, the video of Rigas that I couldn't show you, because that one's not on YouTube, that one's linked here on the screen. I can put that up on YouTube and I can send the URL out so that those of you who are interested could look at it. That's pretty straightforward. Okay. Anything else?
Just a curiosity, I just found out a bit of information on the Greek Civil War. I was fought in Greece from 1946 to 49 between the Greek government army backed by the United Kingdom and the United States and the Democratic Army of Greece, backed by the Communist Party.
Yeah.
So, yeah. Just to be definitive on that.
Yeah, yeah, absolutely. But the interesting thing, again, you read these things, and you know, how much is it? Is that the full? It's not so much as lies or not true. It's just that it's not always the full story, you know. Because the full story is the full story. But what I have read is that the Civil War's going on, and Churchill and Stalin had already separated, you know, all of Europe. You know what I mean? And that those agreements were already made. And so it's always.
Yeah, but the people were not ready to abide by them.
Well, that's true too. And then the people say, "Well, you were separate agreements on and on and on." Well, if that's it, then I'll say thank you very much, everyone, for your attention. Please eat all the Greek food because I don't like it. So.
There is no more.
Oh, good.
Enjoy.
Actually, one really funny story about that is I was in a restaurant. This is one of Dionysus' favorite stories. That we were in a restaurant, they took me out to dinner one time, and we're sitting there, and actually on the way to the restaurant, we're all in a car speaking Greek, and Terry, his wife, said, "Wait a minute, we should speak English because of Jesse." And I said, "No, it's all right, it's all right, don't worry about it." And I said, "Well, see, that's because we consider you such family, that they just speak Greek and don't realize it comes from Greek." And then we go to the restaurant, and we're eating these little tiny, they want me to eat these little fish. Bonnie will tell you, I'm not the most adventurous eater, right? There's little things that are eaten like French fries, right? You know? And so don't know, or anchovies or something, or some other little fish. And Dionysa said to me, they were talking about it, Dionysa turned to me and said, Jesse, what do you call these in English? And I said, bait. and again, you don't really know, Dionysa's a great, he loves to laugh. You know, if you've ever seen somebody who loves to laugh, Dionysa loves to laugh. He cracked up. He just cracked up at this. I mean, it's like the oldest joke in the book, right? You know? He cracked up. And of course, Rigas said, what'd he say? What'd he say? It was so funny. And he told him, so yeah, I had the whole place laughing at him. One little old fashioned joke. One of these little things for me. It was a lot of fun. Okay?